I think it's time to start. So today I want to prove what is called the group configuration theorem. Okay, so what is this about? So last time I have alluded already to this idea. The point is that assume you are in some first order theory T, and assume that it happens that your theory is not disintegrated. So assume it admits some interesting algebraic interdependencies on some tuples of its elements. Okay, and the idea will be to show that in fact any non-disintegrated kind of algebraic interdependence between elements can only come when you have a definable group in your structure. Well, assuming your structure is tame enough. Okay. So what we want to do today, we want to find methods to find groups from some very generically given data. So whenever we have some interesting algebraic interdependencies between elements, we want to construct a group out of it, which will show that, in fact, this must come from the group operation. And this is something that is one of the central ideas of geometric stability theory. We have methods to construct groups from some very generic data, from some very generically given kind of group operation. And this is where all these notions of non-forking, generic independence, etc., come into play. So you'll see today how having these techniques to deal with generic elements in our monster model will allow us to find definable or type definable objects starting just from some very generically given interdependence between elements. Okay, so let me begin by talking about germs of definable functions. Oops. So the idea here is that we want to learn how to deal with a family of germs of functions, where intuitively a germ of a function just means that it's a function which is defined in an infinitesimal neighborhood of some type in my structure. Okay. So I want to see how to work with them, how to compose them, how to define them, etc. So for this, we need to introduce some terminology. Let me fix two global types, P and Q. So I recall these are just types over the monster model. Now, assume I'm given two partial definable functions. Which are defined in P, which means that my type P implies that whenever that X is in the domain of the corresponding functions, okay, then we will say that they have the same germ at P, if this type P of X implies that the value of F1 on X is equal to the value of F2 on X. So intuitively, I'm given my model, the monster model M. I'm given some global type, which you should think about as some kind of ideal point over M. And then the type, P bar, it consists of formulas, which gives me closer and closer approximations to this point, which I think about as the realization of my type. So you should think about formulas and this type as neighborhoods, as a family of neighborhoods of P. Right, and we know that if you intersect all these neighborhoods, then what you get is exactly the global type P. And I want to understand how to talk about germs of such functions. So here, this just means that I'm given some formulas, some two ternary formulas, which define the some ternary relations, such that whenever, such that on some set, in fact, they define graph of a function, so it's a partial definable functions, and we want to require that they're both defined at P. So meaning that the formula, which, so it's an expressible formula, right, because both Fi's are definable. So the formula which says X is in the domain of Fi is in fact a formula in this type, okay? And we say that they have the same germ if this type implies that their values are equal, okay? And as you can see, of course, by compactness, by saturation of the monster, there would be already some finite formula in this type, which implies this equality, right? For a given pair of functions. So what we want to do, we want to start with a family of functions and define a notion of equivalence, which means that if you get to a sufficiently small neighborhood of P bar, then they're going to be equal in this infinitesimal neighborhood of P bar, okay? So for this, we define the notion of germ of a definable function. So this is 2, the germ of F at P is simply the equivalence class. Which I will denote as F tilde of F under this equivalence relation. Okay. So the equivalence relation is that the type, the global type P bar, implies that my two functions are equal on X. Okay. So it's easy to see that if I'm given some third function, for which the same condition holds, then this is transitive and symmetric, et cetera. So it's an equivalence relation on functions, on partial functions defined at P. Okay? And the germ of a function is simply the class. So this is the behavior of my function at an infinitesimal element, at an infinitesimal neighborhood of P bar, intuitively. Okay? Now we will write that F tilde, the germ of tilde is from P bar to Q bar if our global type P of X implies that Q of F of X holds for some, equivalently any, representative of this class. Okay, so I simply want to ensure that if I apply this definable function to a realization of P, I get a realization of Q. Okay, but if we don't want to talk about realizations, we don't want to go outside of the monster model, equivalently we can say that the type for X satisfying P implies that the image of X under F satisfies Q. Okay, and this does not depend on the representative, of course, because all representatives are equal according to P. Okay, now for if I'm given a germ from P to Q, if it has a representative F, which happens to be defined over parameter B, and we take a realization of A, we take a realization of P bar restricted to this parameter B, then we let the value of the germ on this element A be the value of this representative on A. Okay, so here this means I have my I pick a representative, which is defined over some parameters. Now I realize my global type over all those parameters involved. by A, and then I want to define the value of my germ on this element to be simply the value of this representative. And the point is that this is well defined. So it doesn't depend on the choice of my representative. And it's equal, and moreover, since we're assuming that our germ goes from P to Q, the value satisfies Q over the same parameters over B. Y, I guess. Okay. So does this make sense? The point is that, again, it doesn't depend on the choice of the representative because we only want to look at the values of this representative on elements which are realized over type over all the parameters involved. Then these parameters already witness all the equality, et cetera, that we need. So it's easy to see that this is well-defined. It doesn't depend on the choice of F. And that the value of the germ realizes the target type Q over whatever parameters we started with. Okay, so we can talk now. Now it makes sense to talk about the value of a germ of a function at a type. Okay. Then assume we are given F tilde, a germ from P to Q, and assume we have an automorphism sigma of the monster model. Yes. Of y. Let's say wherever I started with my p and q, so I have p of x and q of y. Okay, so here, here f tilde of a realizes q bar restricted to the parameters over which a realized p to begin with. Okay, so it's easy to see it's well defined. Now, assume I'm given an automorphism. We can apply this automorphism to our germ. So then we have a well-defined germ sigma of F tilde, which goes from the image of the type P relatively to sigma to the image of Q relatively to sigma. So simply because automorphism preserves this whole situation. Okay. Next, so we can talk about codes. So we will say that an element in MEQ B is a code for my germ, F tilde, if for any automorphism, sigma, of the monster, we have that sigma fixes this element B if and only if sigma fixes the germ as well. So F tilde is equal to sigma of F tilde.
Let's
see. I must have skipped something, right? Because it's 7 here. And these numbers were assigned automatically. I didn't choose them. But it doesn't matter. I don't think we need anything. So let's just assume 6. 6 wasn't needed. Okay, now 8. So we have defined codes, right? So we have a code. We have a definition of a code for germ. So it's the same idea as for codes for definable sets, right? I want to any automorphism to fix this code whenever it fixes my object. Okay. Now, if we have such a code, so if B is a code for F tilde, then we define the canonical parameter of f tilde to be the definable closure of the code. Okay. So again, the same idea that we had for types. I simply want to take the definably closed set, which contains this this code, the smallest one. Okay. Now, this notion. So far we have discussed global types, right? So we have discussed global types, but as you remember, we have a notion of a stationary type, a type which has a unique global non-forking extension. So this definition can be straightforwardly extended to stationary types. So if we are given P and Q, so no bars now, just P and Q, two stationary types, such that P bar and Q bar are their global non-forking extensions. So each of them has a unique one by assumption. Extensions. Then, by a germ at P, is defined simply as a germ at P bar. Okay, and we write that F tilde, the germ F tilde goes from P to Q, to denote that we have a germ F tilde from the corresponding global non-forking extensions, P bar to Q bar, in the sense defined above. Okay? And finally, I will use the following notation. So given a stationary type P, we will write P over A, a set of parameters. So for all A subsets of the monster, we will write P over A to denote the unique non-forking extension of P to this set of parameters A. Equivalently, P over A is equal to P bar restricted to the set of parameters A. Okay, so it's unique, so it's well defined for any set of parameters. Okay, let's make some remarks about this definition. So first of all, we can compose germs. So composition of germs on global types is well defined. Right? So namely, if I'm given some global types PQR, and I have some germ, let's say F tilde and G tilde, then we have, this produces a well-defined germ from P to R, which we denote as the composition of the two. And this is well-defined because you just check through the definition. So you know, we know that this type says that any realization of F evaluated on this type realizes Q. So then we can take composition because the same holds for G. This way we get a germ from P to R. Okay, so we can compose germs between global types. So and since we can do it for global types, according to our definition, the same makes sense for stationary types. So on global types, Hence, on stationary types, okay, and then this gives us a category. In which objects are given by the stationary types, and morphisms are given by the germs. Okay. So we can talk about a category of these generically defined maps, germs of functions. Now, we will write that a germ F from P to Q is invertible. We will denote it by tilde over the arrow. So we'll write this when the germ is invertible in this category. General categorical definition of invertibility. Equivalently, this can be characterized a germ is invertible whenever F is injective on P. Okay, and to see the equivalence, we clearly have that it's necessary and if injectivity holds then we already by compactness can find some formula on which it's injective. On some formula in our type, let's say phi of x in p bar, and once you are given a definable function on a formula which is injective, you can of course define its inverse, right? So hence, f has a well-defined definable inverse. Yes.
The mean may be smaller than
the what, sorry?
The mean of the inverse may be smaller than Q, right? But there's no subjectivity assumption.
Wait, why smaller than Q? Q will certainly hold, sorry? So we know our type says, right, that if I pick any representative, and if I work over a sufficiently large set of parameters, then this type says that that applying F to whatever here gives me a realization of Q over the corresponding parameters. So the point is that I can do it over any sort of parameters I want. Right. Okay, so we can compose germs. We have a notion of invertibility. And if you look at the codes relatively to these operations, then we had that the canonical parameter of the composition of two germs is contained in the definable closure of the germs of these two functions. And for the inverse, it's simply the same canonical parameter. right? So of course, whenever you're defining an inverse, you're defining it over the same parameters. You don't need any new parameters for this. And when you want to define a composition, to find a formula defining this composition, you only need to take parameters which were involved in the formula defining f and g. Okay. Now, let's remark that in fact, we always have canonical parameters. So we will be assuming from now on that t is stable, which we know we have already proved, which implies that all types are definable. So in particular, p and q are definable types. Or maybe let me say this is context rather than remark. Okay, so t is stable. Any two global types are definable. Now, assume I'm given a definable family of partial functions. So let fz be an empty set definable. Family of partial functions. Okay? So it means the same thing as when we talked about families of curves. It means that I have a relation with an additional parameter. And fixing that parameter determines my function fz. Okay, so i.e. exists some formula capital F of xyz such that for any z, if we look at the corresponding so we fix z, and then we denote the corresponding function. So fz of xy is the graph okay, sorry. So then we will write fz for the function is the function, the partial function whose graph is given by f of xy with the z fixed. Okay? So you want a uniformly definable family. So each function in my family is defined by putting some parameters into this formula. Okay? So assume we are given such a definable family. Now the point is that we can express equality of germs in a definable manner. So equality of germs for functions in this definable family is itself a definable equivalence relation. Why? Well, let's see. So the equality of germs of two members of this family, let's say FB and FC at the global type P is a definable equivalence relation. Which we will denote as E of B of C. So why is it the case? Well, because of the definability of types. So you want, in order to check that these two functions have the same germ, we want to say that a certain formula is in the type, right? But since the type is definable, we know that we can define the set of those parameters B and C for which any specific formula is in the type. So, namely, consider the formula phi of x with two parameters bc, which we take to say that x is in the domain of fb, intersected with the domain of fc, and the value of fb on x is equal to the value of fc on x. So this is our formula phi. Now we have that the germs of FB and FC at P are equal if and only if this formula belongs to the type, right, by definition of the germ equivalence relation. But now we know that this is the same condition as for the definition of our type to hold on these parameters. So the point is that by stability, the set of all those BC for which this formula is in the type is itself a definable set. And it's defined by this definition schema, which we denote as dp bar of phi on parameters BC, right? Okay, so hence, we can take the equivalence relation to be simply this formula. We have that E of BC holds if and only if the germ of FB is equal to the germ of FC. Okay. So now, given this definable family in a stable theory and the global type, we can define those pairs of parameters which, for which the corresponding functions in the family have the same germ at P. Okay. And we remark that since applying an automorphism sigma to the germ FB is the same thing as looking at the germ of the given by the corresponding parameter, by the corresponding image of the parameter sigma of B, then we have that the canonical parameter of FB tilde, according to our definition, is given by the definable closure of this element B over, B mod E. Okay, so this is the corresponding element in MEQ. So it's an imaginary which is given by the class of B relative to this equivalence relation. Okay. So these are some general observations. So in stable theories, we actually have canonical parameters. And now we need some properties of such families. So we will be working with a definable family of partial functions, and we will want to understand the germs of this family. So assume that we're given three types PQS over the empty set, but all of these types are stationary. Okay, then we will a family of germs, which we will denote as F tilde subscript S, family FS of germs from P to Q is the family given by all the germs F tilde B, where B is any realization of my type S. Okay, so where these are germs from P to Q. At P, so P is a stationary type, of an empty set definable family of functions FZ such that the germ FB is always from P to Q whenever B realizes S. So this is just a shortcut for expressing such a situation. So we We will talk about a family of germs from P to Q, where my family of functions is definable. And the parameters vary over some different stationary type S. So now my germs are parameterized by realizations of this type S relatively to some definable family. Okay. Now we will say that such a family is canonical if every such parameter B is a code for F tilde B for all B realizing S. Okay, so even if we start with this family, maybe it's parameterized by some arbitrary collection of parameters, not necessarily given the codes, then we would always want to replace it with the family of codes. All of this is interdefinable. Next, we will say that the family is generically transitive if we have that applying a germ FB to X, it's going to be independent from X for some, equivalently any, B and X, such that B realizes S and X realizes P over this parameter. Okay, so I want to say that if I have a parameter which is independent in particular, sorry, if I have X, which is in particular an argument X, which is in particular independent from the parameter B, then the image of my function is independent from the argument. Okay. Exercise. A family is generically transitive if and only if we have the following: for any X realizing P and for any Y realizing Q over X, we can find some B, another parameter realizing S, such that F tilde B of X is equal to Y. So it means that given any realization of P and any realization of Q over the previous realization, we can find a parameter such that one is sent to the other. Y the corresponding germ, sorry. Okay. And now is the crucial proposition, which connects families of germs with some non-trivial interdefinability connection. So we will call this proposition finding families of germs. We will use it later. Okay, so suppose we're given PQS, stationary types over the empty set, and we look at the corresponding family of germs from P to Q. Then, if I take some B realizing S, and so parameter, I choose a function. Now I take an argument which is independent over these parameters, so it realizes P over these parameters. And if Y is the image, then Then we observe the following. So X is independent from B, Y is independent from B, and Y belongs to the definable closure of the pair BX. Let me denote this condition star. Okay, so as you can see, X is independent from B because P is a non-forking type. So I take a non-forking extension to B, so X is independent from B. Y is independent from B because Y right, because Y is just in the definable closure. And Y is in the definable closure of both because Y is the image of a function with parameters from B evaluated on X. Okay. Now the point is that any such configuration of elements in my structure satisfying star gives rise to a family of germs. So this makes a connection between definable functions and some elements in my structure in some interdefinable position. Okay, so conversely, if I'm given any elements BXY, which satisfies this condition star, then we can take FB of X equal to Y be a formula which witnesses that Y is in the definable closure. FB is a partial definable function. Right? So remember that being in the definable closure means that you have some formula over these parameters, so B and X, such that Y is its only solution, right? But now we can modify this formula by adding that for any choice of the parameters of this formula, there is only one solution. Okay? And then this gives us a partial function such that in particular, Y is the image of this partial function relatively to X. So now this formula, which just establishes this dependence here, this definability of Y over this, it immediately gives us a family of functions. Right, so we have this formula. Now I have to tell you the types. So we let S be the type of B. P is the type of X. And Q is the type of Y. Then this gives us a family of germs from P to Q. Okay, so we have this correspondence between families of germs and definable closure relation of this form. Moreover, we have the following correspondences. One, the germ is invertible at B, so the germ of FB is invertible. If in addition, X also belongs to the definable closure of BY. Okay, so here we know how to get Y from BX. I'm claiming that you can, if you can also get X from BY, then this germ is invertible. Next, the family of these germs of S is generically transitive If and only if in addition we have that x is independent from y. And three, if we look at the code, at the canonical parameter of FB, the germ of FB, this is simply the canonical base of the type of XY over B. Hence, this family is canonical if and only if the canonical base of XY over B is equal to B. Okay, so this is just this is an exercise. So it's just unwinding the definitions, really. Okay, so we have this very precise correspondence between properties of the corresponding family of germs and the dependences or independences among these tuples x, b, and y. And now, since we know how to talk about such generic families, we can prove the so-called Khrushchevsky-Weyl theorem, or sometimes it's called the group chunk theorem. So the point will be that we start with some group, or rather an action of a group on a homogeneous space, which is given generically. So we'll assume that we have an operation which is defined on independent realizations of some types in our configuration. And what we will show is that if I'm only given this generically defined operation of a group, satisfying properties of multiplication in a group, then in fact I can find a type definable group from which this generic operation comes. Okay? So we will obtain a definable object simply from some generically given trace of a group in our structure. So we will in general, one doesn't necessarily find a definable group in a general stable theory, but rather a type definable group. So let me say a couple of words about this. We'll denote by a type definable or wedge definable homogeneous space which is given by group G and a set S on which it acts. So it's given by a type definable set S and the type definable group G, where type definable group means that the underlying set of the group is type definable, and the group the graph of the multiplication is relatively definable. On this set G cube. Just a second. So it's not lambda, it's wedge. Okay, so it's relatively definable on the set G. And finally, the action is also relatively definable. And the word homogeneous corresponds to the fact that G is acting transitively. on S. Okay, now let me define some of the words that appear here. So I recall that we work in a saturated model. We work in a monster model M. Now a type definable set S, subset of some power of my model, is type definable of edge definable. If S is given by the set of solutions of some small type. So S is of the form phi of M, where phi of X is a small partial type. I recall small means smaller than the saturation of the monster, over a set of parameters smaller than saturation of the monster. So for example, let me look at the non-standard model of the additive group of the reals. Okay, so some non-standard extension of R. Okay, then we can look at the set of infinitesimals. So if I look at the set of all x in R star, such that x is bigger than 0 and smaller than, so let's say x is between minus 1 over n and 1 over n for all n in omega, then this is a type definable subset of this non-standard model. Okay, of wedge definable. Of R star, right? Yeah, I'll say after I define this. Okay, so this is an example of a type definable. Of a type definable set. Moreover, you can notice in this case that this is a group. So the infinitesimals form a group. It's a type definable group. And it's not hard to check that there is no, so first of all, of course, this set has no solutions in the initial model. So for this notion to be interesting, we need to work in a saturated model. And you can check in this case that it's not a definable set. So it's, you can only obtain it as a type definable set. Now, we say that the set is relatively definable if its intersection with a type definable set, if it's given by an intersection of a formula with a type definable set. So assume I'm given a type definable set like this, S, then Y, subset of some power of S, let's say, is relatively definable if Y is of the form Z intersected with SN, where Z is a definable subset of the monster. Okay, so in this case, the domain of my group is given by an intersection of infinitely many formulas. The operation is given by a single formula. And it satisfies the axioms. Okay. So this is the next best thing. If you, in fact, you, for your intuition, you can just think about everything here being definable. We will see, that in a nomical category, in a nomical stable setting, instead of type definable, you actually get definable. So you can do better. Okay. In any case, so this is a type definable homogeneous space. Now, two, we will say that S is connected. So given such a homogeneous space, S is connected if exists a stationary type, little s, which extends the formula S. Not the formula, sorry, which extends the partial type S. Okay, such that whenever we have an element of our group and B realizes this type over this element, then multiplying, acting by G on this element, still gives us a realization of S over G. Another way to express it is that the stabilizer of S is all of G. So there is a unique generic element in the homogeneous space. And finally, we define, we can talk, okay, so sorry. So this S, I haven't said it. So this S is called the generic type of S, okay? And finally, the generics of G are defined by considering the action of G on itself. So the same definition for G acting on itself. Okay. Exercise. So this notion can be characterized by Morley rank in the omega categorical case. So if GS happens to be definable of finite Morley rank, then S is connected if and only if the Morley degree of S is equal to 1 and the type of an element A for some element A in this set S is generic, if and only if the rank of A is the same as the rank of the whole set. Okay, so an element of a homogeneous space or of a group is generic if it doesn't satisfy any new conditions. So, which you remember, we implement by saying that the rank doesn't drop. So it means that, for example, in the case of an algebraic group, this means that A does not belong to any variety of smaller dimension. Okay, so it really doesn't satisfy any new conditions. So it's a generic type. Okay, and now we can state the group chunk theorem. So I make precise this intuition about how to get a type definable group from a generically given operation, which looks like a group operation. So let P and S be two types over the empty set, stationary. Suppose that we have a family of Jorams, a generically transitive, canonical, family of invertible Jorams from P to itself, okay, so start with a family of Jorams from a stationary type P to itself, parameterized as nicely as possible. Suppose, in addition, that this family is closed under inverse. Okay, so an inverse of any function of any germ from P to P with some parameter s can be represented as the germ from the same family, but with potentially some different parameter s prime. So it's closed under inverse. And generic composition. Which means that for all B realizing S, there is some B prime realizing S such that the inverse of the germ FB is given by the germ of FB prime. So this is the invertibility condition. And for any B1, B2 realizing S, so any two parameters, such that B1 is independent from B2, we can find some B3, some third parameter, such that taking the composition of the germs of FB1 with FB2 is given by the germ FB3. And this B3 is independent from both of the parameters I started with. Okay, so this is the assumption of my family of germs. I assume that I can take inverses, and I assume that I can compose them generically. So it's not necessarily the case that any two germs from my family can be composed to obtain another germ in this family. But whenever the parameters are independent enough from each other, then I can compose them and still get a germ in my family. Okay. Then, in MQ, there is a type definable group. Acting on a type definable set, so there is a type definable homogeneous space GS, and there is a definable embedding of the type little s into this group. As its unique generic type and a definable embedding of P into S, so the set on which G acts, as its unique generic type again. Such that now the action of the group on S commutes commutes with the action of the type S on the type P in the following sense. Such that if I look at the germ of FB at A, then this is equal to the action of an element B in my group on A for B realizing S and A realizing P over the parameters B. Okay, so taking plane germ to A corresponds to the action of the group on S. Okay, so we start essentially with this assumption in a very generic form. So there's nothing definable here. We're just given a family. And generically, we can compose them. Just from this assumption, we can in fact find a type definable group working in MQ, which tells us exactly that applying these theorems corresponds to the action of this group. Okay, so this is the group chunk theorem. So we're given a generic piece, a generically given piece of a group, group action, and we find an actual type-definable group action. It's just a definable map. Just a definable map of the set of realizations of a type into the group. Yeah, sorry, I guess when I say type, I should write, to be more precise, the set of solutions of the type, right? That's what I mean. Okay. Let's prove this. So we're given this family of germs, right? Let me take it, let me look at the group generated by these germs under composition. Yes, question? Yes, that's the idea. Yeah. Right. Yeah, exactly. Right, exactly. So the point here, not only you find the group, but in fact it comes from this. So it comes from, generically it coincides with my generic operation. But now I find an actual definable operation whose generic behavior is what I started with. Okay, so let's look at the group G. Let it be the group of germs generated by the family I'm starting with. Okay, so the invertible, I can compose them, so I get some group of germs. Okay, now what we want to show, so claim one, any element of G is a composition of two generators. Okay? So we know that we can compose generically. Any composition of any two germs in my family still gives me a germ in my family. However, what happens if I composition of any germs in my family with parameters sufficiently independent gives me a germ in my family. What I'm saying here is that now I drop the assumption on the parameters. I want to compose arbitrary germs. And what this claim says is that I never have to go further than a double composition with no requirement on the independence of the parameters. So now composition of any number of germs in my family can be obtained as a composition of at most two germs in my family. You cannot drop this to one in general, but you only need two. Okay, let's prove the claim. So first, our assumption was that the family is closed under inverses. Right? So this implies that the identity is the composition of two generators. Okay. Now, note that S is a complete type. Little s is a complete type. And we have generic composition plus homogeneity of the monster model imply together that any generator is the composition of two generators. So how is this achieved using generic composition? Well, the point is that I can take a new parameter independent from the old one, then I can compose, but then I can send them back to the initial. I can send one of them back to the initial element in the generating set by an automorphism. Okay, so this is a small exercise to check. So the identity is given by composition of two germs in my family, and every germ in the generating set is itself a composition of two germs using generic composition. Okay, now it suffices to show that any composition of three generators let's say FB1 tilde, FB2 tilde, FB3 tilde is already the composition of two generators. Okay, so if I'm given three germs in my family and I compose them, I can already obtain it as a composition of some two germs in my family. And then inductively, we would be done. So okay, let's show it. So let's fix these three germs, B1, B2, B3. And let's pick another parameter, B prime, which realizes S independently from all this data involved. So it's independent from B1, B2, B3. Okay. Then we can write this composition. Okay, so let's write star here. So this composition is equal to the composition of FB1 tilde with FB prime tilde with FB prime tilde minus 1 with FB2 tilde with FB3 tilde. Okay, so I can plug in the identity. And my idea will be now to cut this into two. So I want to show that this is a germ and this is a germ in my family. Okay. Now we use some forking calculus. So we have established this various properties of the independence relation. So we have, of course, that B prime is independent from B2, right? Because it was independent from all these parameters. So B1, B prime is independent from B2. So we can take the generic composition. We have generic compositions, so we can compose them. So we have that F tilde to the minus 1, B prime, composed with F tilde B2 is equal to F tilde B double prime for some element B double prime realizing S, right? So recall that we're assuming that germs in our family are invertible and closed, the family is closed under generic composition. So here the parameters are independent now. So compose them. So we get B prime realizing S. Moreover, B double prime is independent from B prime. And B double prime is independent from B2. Okay. Next, we have that B prime is independent from B3 over B2. Okay. So if you remember, okay, so the assumption is that it's independent from B3, B2 over the empty set, but you can always put it down by transitivity of forking. So then we have that B double prime is independent from B3 over B2. Since B double prime is in the definable closure of B prime B2, Okay. So since we have this independence, and in addition, we know that B double prime is independent from B2. Okay, so combining this with this, sorry, not this, drew the wrong circle. This, combining this with this, by transitivity of forking, it follows that B double prime is independent from B3. Okay. Also, we know that B prime is independent from B1. Okay. And so now we're in a situation when on each of the sides, the parameters are generically distributed here. Okay. So it follows that the germs, so by generic composition in the family that we started with, we have that the germs of the composition of FB1 with FB prime tilde and the composition of FB prime tilde to the minus 1 with FB2 tilde with FB3 tilde appear in our family. F tilde S, okay? So this concludes the argument. So this shows that composition of any number of germs in my family is given at most by the composition of some two germs in my family. And just 30 seconds. So now, because of this, we can see how to type define G. So now G is type definable with the underlying set, the set of all pairs of parameters of germs in our family. So as pairs of realizations of S modulo the equality of the corresponding compositions of germs . Okay, and the group operation is just the composition of germs. Okay, so this gives the definition of the group, and after the break we'll see we'll demonstrate that it is indeed connected with the closely with the configuration we started with. Okay, thank you.